to receive the richness of God's love given for you.
In our gospel today, most of the folks who hear Jesus talking about this flesh and blood and eating and drinking, most get confused with all this talk and they walk away, saying it is too much. And I don't blame them. And then there's some of them who actually get what Jesus is saying, and it is still too much, and they walk away. So once again, surprise, surprise, it's easier for me to identify with the crowds who walk away than with Jesus who's trying to explain himself. Because what Jesus is saying here is indeed hard to listen to and hard to understand. That Jesus is the bread of life, that he provides the only food that actually nourishes us, that he gives us his own self, his own flesh and blood to sustain us on the journey. It's hard to wrap our minds around. I even got a little squeamish reading it. It's no wonder, then, that many of those who are following Jesus in the story, they now leave. They go somewhere else to find answers to life's big questions. And these aren't just bystanders who happen to come upon Jesus, hear him once and leave. These are folks who had, in fact, believed in Jesus and had been following him for some time, and they'd given up much to do so. But now, finally, after all of our meeting and watching and wondering and worrying, they've grown tired. And they can't see clearly what it is about Jesus that attracted them to him in the first place. And so they leave. Again, who can blame them? More to the point, are we all really that different? I mean, who here who has not at one time or another wondered whether you have believed in vain? At Crossroads 2 weeks ago, from 3 to 4 o'clock, it's camp store time, it's snack time, it's kind of free time. When I was in chapel, there was a high school girl who asked me if we could go over some Bible verses during free time that were troubling her. She was gay and had been out for 3 years, and her Lutheran pastor and parents were supportive. But some friends at her high school are not, and they kept throwing Bible verses in her face, telling her that she's going to hell. So we looked at those Bible verses, and I explained a different way to interpret them than her friends. This is the first time this has happened. She looked at me with tears in her eyes and asked, "But what if we, the Lutherans, are wrong about God?" Maybe you don't know what it's like to question your faith that way, but I bet many of you have wondered if our faith in God is real. During the dark of night, perhaps, watching and praying at the bedside of a child or a parent in the hospital, wondering why he or she is so sick. Or maybe in the early part of the morning, waking up alone and wondering why your spouse isn't there anymore. Or maybe in the latter part of the afternoon, by everything supper and thinking about your family, the ones so full of ill will toward each other, and wondering why things have not turned out the way you hoped, and wondering if they ever will. At these times, in my word, if we're honest, we must admit that there are many of them in life. At these times, we're looking for God, some sense that there is a God, and we can have such a hard time seeing God that we are also tempted to conclude the promises that we trusted are empty, and what if the faith that we've held is misplaced? And so I bet that the picture that St. John paints for us in today's reading might not be a pretty one, but it is real. It is, in other words, a pretty accurate picture of Jesus surrounded by those who want to believe, who used to believe, who are trying to believe, but have been going through a lot, and some want to give up. So what does Jesus do? Pack it all up in the face of our inability to believe sometimes? Leave us in our darkness and just head home? No. Jesus never could and still never can leave us. Never leave the chance to be in relationship. Peter, at some level, gets that piece about Jesus and speaks up. That's what makes Peter and the disciples different from the rest of the crowds. Not that they're brains or that they're faith canoe mountains, they've just experienced and seen that Jesus won't stop wanting to be more relationship with us. And now we come full circle to Jesus being the bread of life, both then and now and always. And it's not just any old bread of life, but it is bread given for you. Luther said those two words are the most important in the whole communion story. It just takes your breath away, doesn't it? Here is Jesus Christ, the Word of God made flesh, making this astounding promise. I am the bread of life, and I'm giving it to you so that you can live, really live, starting now, here on this side of heaven, and extending to the next. Jesus speaks still to us today about this bread. In whatever state you find yourself today, the promise of the one who is the light of the world, the good shepherd, the way, the truth, the resurrection, and the life is unbreakable. There is not a single person in this room who doesn't know what it's like to feel lost in confusion and doubt when it comes to faith in this heartbreaking world. We know this feeling, and it cuts across cultures, races, languages, and nationalities. It is a feeling that is universal to the human experience. And it is against that very experience that Jesus says to you, promises to you, swearing an oath with his body and blood, that in this meal, Jesus is with you always. And you are not alone. In this meal, we are given brothers and sisters at this table. But more importantly, we are given the one who is the bread of life, who meets us in ordinary bread, and the one who is the true vine, who meets us in wine and root juice. And in it we have life. And we get to invite